Joining JW3 this evening for our annual Kristallnacht commemorative event. Thank you to City of London Sinfonia for playing so beautifully while we settled into our seats. My name is Tamar Barnett and I am the Holocaust Education Programmer at JW3. We warmly welcome an audience in the building as well as online. The pandemic has given us a chance to reach more people, and I am pleased to say that we are beaming online into living rooms all over Britain and stretching into Europe and beyond. This evening, we are remembering and commemorating Kristallnacht, or November pogrom, which happened 84 years ago. During this night, the Nazis initiated a campaign of hatred against the Jewish population in all Nazi territories. An estimated 91 Jews were killed, 30,000 arrested and imprisoned in concentration camps, 267 synagogues and over 7,000 shops and other Jewish businesses were destroyed and looted. It was a wake-up call for the rest of the world to act and react to what was a clear sign that Nazi policy had now moved into the overt destruction of all Jewish life in the Third Reich. Tonight, the human story behind the horrific statistics will be highlighted as we focus on the accounts of eyewitnesses. We find out how that fateful night affected people's lives, but we will also learn about the resilience and vibrancy of the Jewish community, despite the terrible losses and extreme hardships they've suffered. A community that doesn't shy away from its difficult, tragic past, but uses it to educate and warn against the dangers of prejudice and racism. We are privileged to hear from Elsa Shamash, born in 1927 in Berlin. She and her family experienced firsthand the effect of anti-Jewish legislation. Elsa was 11 years old when she left Germany in 1939 on the Kindertransport. Today, Elsa speaks in schools about her experiences and has been the focus of an exhibition both in Germany and Britain. We are also casting an eye to the future of Holocaust education and commemoration as we are moving away from it being within living memory. We are delighted to be joined by Deputy Head of Mission, Mr. Rudiger Bohn, who has been in post at the German Embassy in London since August. His career has included posts at German diplomatic missions in Amman, Brussels, Tashkent, and Washington, D.C. He also worked in various departments at the Federal Foreign Office and at the Federal Chancery in Berlin. To facilitate the conversations, JW3 is honored to have on stage Ruth-Anne Lenga, Associate Professor and Program Director of UCL's Center for Holocaust Education. Ruth-Anne is a long-standing expert in Holocaust education and UK delegate of the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance. She played a key role in establishing the UCL Center for Holocaust Education and shaped its direction. She oversees the center's online master's module, The Holocaust and the Curriculum, which is rooted in the center's groundbreaking research findings. In addition, she directed the education department at the Jewish Museum London, developed and led on using the museum's collection effectively and sensitively when teaching and learning about the Holocaust. Finally, JW3 is proud to introduce City of London Sinfonia, who will be performing a selection of music this evening, as well as a specially developed segment in partnership with JW3, of which later more. City of London Sinfonia gives over 75 performances each year, performing regularly at the Albany, Canada Water Theatre, South Bank Centre's Queen Elizabeth Hall, Southwark Cathedral, and St. Paul's Cathedral. It is also proud to be resident orchestra at Opera Holland Park since 2004. The orchestra is leading the way in creative collaborative practice in health and social care through its participation program. In the 2020 Royal Philharmonic Society Awards, they received the Impact Award for their Sound Young Minds project, which provides opportunities to young people in psychiatric hospitals. Other core projects include room-to-room music with residents in care homes and music for children in London hospitals, to name a few. Now, before I welcome Elsa and Shamash and Ruth and Lenga on stage, can I please ask everyone to put their mobile phones on silent? To start the evening, there will be a short filmed clip of Elsa speaking, and this will form the foundation of the interview to follow.
Bohn, and I will never forget this because it was in Gestapo, and they said, "Will you tell the doctor?" Well, I said, the doctor will come to the phone, and when my father went to the phone, it was silent. Somebody was warning him. He just got up, packed a tiny case, and said goodbye. And for 3 days, we had no idea where my father was. And I think there was shouting too, because there were Jewish shops locally, and they had smashed the windows, and people were allowed to loot, to take anything they wanted. When the synagogues were burning, the sky was of course lit up, and the fire brigade did nothing except stop the houses around from catching fire. And nothing can actually explain the fear and terror of everybody, of all the Jewish population, because it was absolutely clear there was no staying in Germany for us. And we as children completely understood this.
It is for us to be with you this evening on this important anniversary of the November pogrom, a critical and most terrifying turning point in what was to follow. You spoke so powerfully in the film of the fear that you felt as a child living through it and knowing without question that to stay where you were, you, any Jew, to stay any more in Germany, you know, was impossible. That you had to get out for your own safety, and it's pretty hard for us to even comprehend what that must mean for a child of 11. To have grasped, to have that level of fear and to know that there is no safety anymore in your home. What that does to a person and what that does to your childhood.
Well, it was, we were prepared almost for this because people had to put outside there on the Jewish shops, Jude, so that they would know that they could smash the windows and steal anything they wanted. And for people like my parents, it was especially difficult because throughout the Weimar Republic, Jews had been accepted and they thought they were German citizens of Jewish religion and they had full civil rights, and all of a sudden
this happened.
Those rights were taken away.
And I know that your father and your mother was a rather well-to-do lady, but she and your father served for Germany in the First World War.
Yes, my father was a medical officer and my mother was an auxiliary nurse, and four of her five brothers actually did fight in the German army because they'd been in Germany for donkey's years and they thought it was their duty to do this.
Tell the audience and people who are Zooming in from home a little bit about your childhood before all this started, before the Nazi regime started to impact.
Well, I was six when the Nazis came. So beforehand, before I went to school, we had two maids, one who looked after just my brother and me, and the other who did the general housework, because before the war, in a middle-class family, you had one or two maids. My mother had never done any housework before she came to England, when she had to do everything. Mm-hmm. We were well-to-do. My father was one of the first radiologists ever. He had a training school for radiographers because the profession of radiology didn't exist till he had trained his own. But of course, the training school had to stop when the Nazis came into power. But he went on working till they also emigrated. The trouble was that, of course, no country would have you. Germany stripped you of all your monies. And as I say, we had been well-to-do. And we used to go and spend the summers at the seaside. And then after 1933, quite often in the adjacent countries. And when we were in Switzerland, where my father was at a medical congress, my mother found that the Swiss were overrun and as Nazi as the Germans. And the J we had in our passports was actually demanded by the Swiss because they also didn't want Jews.
Right. You're a little girl. Tell me about you as the little girl who's going to school. It's a German school, you've got German friends, you've got German friend neighbors. You go over to their house as a little girl, six, and you play with them with this the toy train you were telling me. But things change.
Right. Well, I started school in a little private school, and in 1933, and I made a little friend, Rosemary. And then she came to me and said, my mommy says, I mustn't play with you because you're Jewish. And you should go around the corner to a little boy with a friend of my brother's. And again, the parents said, I'm sorry. We cannot have your children. We cannot associate with you anymore because my husband had to join the party and we're not allowed to associate with Jews.
Did you feel betrayed by that? Do you remember, even as a small child, feeling perhaps a sense of betrayal? Or
well, somehow.
What did that
even
do?
Even at six, we understood. And then when we were about 8 or 9, we couldn't go to the cinema because it says Jews weren't wanted. We couldn't go to the swimming pool. Jews are not wanted. We didn't want to go to the park because children were throwing stones.
And that happened to you on your way
yes,
to school?
Yes, on the way to school, there was one place where we were frightened to go past because there were always some Nazi boys who did throw stones sometimes.
But there was one occasion, I think you told me a week or so ago,
yes.
when it's actually you and your appearance which sort of stopped it from going any further.
My brother and I were walking along on the pavement and I can see 3 Nazi boys coming and they were going to insult us. They said Jews, and then one of them nudged them and said, "No, they're not. Look at the girl." And it's the same. 1933, we were in a suburb, and suddenly my very unobservant brother says, "Look, there's Elsa's portrait in the window. It says, 'Deutsche Mädchen tragen wieder Haarschleifen.' Advertisement for ribbons. And when ribbons were no longer worn, it was Das Deutsche Mädchen. And Das Deutsche Mädchen stayed in the haberdashery shops right up to, when we left. And my parents, of course, were scared stiff that if they had found that Das Deutsche Mädchen was Jewish, it would have meant concentration camp.
How ironic was that, that you're the Deutsche girl, the German girl?
I give it as an example when I talk to children how ridiculous it is to classify somebody by the way they look and causes Islamophobia and anti-feeling.
So you, your brother, Heinz, is due to leave the school and go to a gymnasium.
Well, he
Tell
was...
Tell us about that.
In 36, he was supposed to go to senior school, and my mother went to the grammar school my father had been at, and the headmaster said, "Yes, I'll take him, but I cannot protect him. If the teachers or the children bully him, there's nothing I can do." Well, just imagine a school where the teachers bully the children, and that is what did happen. So we went to a Jewish school in 1936, and there were a lot of Jewish schools. They were not religious, but they were founded by Jewish teachers who lost their job because after 1933, no Jewish person was allowed to teach in a state school.
Thank you. And it was the Kalinsky School? The Kalinsky School?
I went to the Kalinsky School, which was a very progressive school at the other side of Berlin. And even at the age of 8, I would travel on the underground by myself, having to change on the underground, and nothing ever happened.
Unbelievable. In that context, with all that fear going around, how difficult that must have been for you. And what I find remarkable, I mean, that school was incredibly progressive and took action to prepare the children for immigration, and also really to help them with their trauma.
In the year 1 or sixth form, as we used to call it, everything was taught in English by English teachers so that they could go. They took matric
or school certificate, and in those days you could go to university with just at 16, as actually my husband did.
But all this came to an end, of course. We hear on the film what happened on the 9th of November, 84.
I think the school must have stopped functioning as war broke out.
Oh, as war
or
broke
just
out.
After war, okay. Soon after war broke okay. out. I know the headmistress, Lotte Kaliski, was in New York and started a school for intelligent children.
Whatever that may mean. That would count me out, I can tell you that. Anyway, let us go back. So you tell us so vividly what happened when you turned up for school 84 years ago to the day, on the 9th of November 1938. We heard you tell us on the film, and also about when you went home, you had lunch, and that critical phone call that could have been from one of your father's patients.
That's the only explanation he has, that somebody from the Gestapo was warning him not to be at home. He packed a little bag, and for 3 days, we had no idea where he went, what was happening to him. And I think he was riding the underground to be in no one place at one time. And then afterwards, we found out that he had slept at one of his aunts where there were no men, because at the time they were not picking up the men. But the desperation was that you wanted to get away, and like today, no country would have you. The only good thing was that the kinder transport in England was allowed, because luckily we didn't have a Suella Beverman. We had Horbelisha, and we had Lord Samuel.
So, right. You tell us about you seeing the skies light up with the synagogues burning, you hear the looting, the day passes, your father returns. It must have been a terrible relief to know your father was not picked up and taken away. Things, I know it sounds strange to say it, but somehow must have settled a little after that terrible pogrom. And months later, a few months later, your brother is called for his bar mitzvah. Now, his bar mitzvah in what sort of synagogue after that? What's going on there then?
In February 39, my brother was 13, bar mitzvah, no synagogue, because the synagogue had burned down, so we were in a hall, and not the normal rabbi, because the normal rabbi, I think, was in a concentration camp and then possibly had emigrated. Anyway, we had a relief rabbi and no party, just one or two relations in the evening. And then the good thing was we were just gathered and we had a letter saying that my brother and I got on the kinder transport. And that was on his bar mitzvah.
Wow. On your brother's bar mitzvah, you and your brother had a ticket, or a chance, an opportunity to save your life.
Yeah. And obviously we were happy, because we knew there was no possibility of staying in Germany. And my parents had already, because my uncles had already emigrated, one stayed in England, three had gone to California, and they gave us an affidavit, and we thought any day we would get to America. It only took 10 years. It was as difficult as it is today.
So you and your brother boarded the train, kinder transport, difficult journey, still fear, German guards still on the train. But you make it, and you're greeted by your uncle in at the...
Yes, and my uncle's grandchildren are here.
Which is wonderful.
Three of them are sitting over there. So
this is all.
Yes, here, one of my mother's brothers has managed to get us on a kinder transport, and when we got to England, it was far more straightforward because the journey only took 36 hours, not like the children today. And my aunt and uncle were at Liverpool Station, and after a couple of days, we went off to boarding school.
Now, the boarding school experience wasn't a great one for you because this time you suffered some bullying and bad treatment, this time because you were a German girl in their school.
That's right.
So you couldn't win. And it was a time of...
Well, we felt nobody wanted us. It was a hostile environment.
That was hard times.
Because we were... So actually, because then, too, you couldn't be German during the war, we did emphasize our Judaism.
Now, Elsa, it's a great shame, but I've been given the notice that our time is up. So I'm so sorry, but I just want to summarize. You built your life here. Your parents managed to come out. You were with your brother. Your brother was with you. It's a remarkable story that you managed to survive as a family, where we know that so many others didn't. And we know how much you value that. And I know that in your life, and you're living a long life, which is fantastic. You're very active, and you do a lot of work to help refugee children today, don't you? Supporting them, and you've campaigned,
yes,
in Downing Street and Parliament about the welfare of children who come as refugees unaccompanied, and it's remarkable that you do that work. I know you married a fabulous gentleman. You've had children and grandchildren,
great-grandchildren,
kol hakavod, great-grandchildren. May you all be blessed. And I think it's a wonderful achievement. And you are an inspiration to everybody. And I cannot help but remark that your name, your married name, Shamash, is, of course, the servant candle in the Chanukiah, on the festival of Chanukah, the candle that lights all the other lights. And I want to thank you for being here tonight and lighting the light on this dark period in our history so that we can see the humanity and everything you endured. And we've been very much inspired by you and being here to tell us your story from your first-hand account.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Ruth-Anne and Elsa. The next segment is, I think, unique and is going to be very, very moving. JW3 and City of London Sinfonia have worked together to produce the next segment that brings together music and short interviews with people who experienced firsthand what life was like under Nazi rule. Our focus was to build on the work City of London Sinfonia is developing in the community, especially their room-to-room music project, where CLS musicians work with care home residents isolated in their rooms and use responsive, spontaneous music making to create a shared, unique experience together. You will watch short interviews with Eve Kugler and Anne and Bob Kirk. We have identified points to reflect on musically by pausing and inserting suitable photographs to allow people to grasp the enormity of what is being shared. City of London Sinfonia will provide the music live, thus creating a spontaneous musical response to the story. We are hugely grateful to Eve, Anne and Bob for giving up their time and to share their stories with us.
Lived in a very comfortable apartment. So it was my mom, my dad, my two sisters, and myself. And my grandfather, Marcus, my father's father, who was widowed. 10 days before Kristallnacht, on October 29th, two Nazis came to the store. And they arrested my grandfather. And then he was deported to Poland, and we never saw him again. And 10 days later, in the middle of the night, pounding on the door, and you could do nothing but open, and there were five other Nazis, and they came through the apartment and they started turning over the furniture, creating general havoc and destruction. My sister Ruth and I were standing at our bedroom door watching all of this until the local police chief pushed us back into our bedroom and slammed the door in our face. So what we did not see was the destruction in my grandfather's room. Grandfather Marcus was a very religious man. He had there, of course, in his talis, his phylactery, many sacred books, all of which the Nazis tore, destroyed, trampled on. My dad was led out of the home. My mom was in a state of shock through the entire night. In the morning, the doorbell rang. A store assistant in tears saying, you have to come down, you have to come down. And so my mom threw on some clothes and went down to the street where she saw that the store windows had been smashed and glass lit at the sidewalk. Nazis were standing there and told her that she's got to clean up the mess, you filthy, dirty Jews. And a little bit later, one of my dad's sisters, my Aunt Fanny, came and said the prayer house, and this was our synagogue, and that was burned to the ground while the Nazis watched. So my mom shoulders back, put on some decent clothes and marched across the street to the local police station and asked, where's my husband? She was told that he was in the concentration camp of Buchenwald and that if she wanted to get him out of Buchenwald, she had to produce a visa so that he could leave the country, because we don't want Jews in Germany. We don't want Jews in Germany. The refrain that we had been hearing for a number of years. Kristallnacht for me was one of the worst experiences as a child survivor of the Holocaust. My mom, she spoke freely to everybody and anybody who would listen to her, because she believed everybody had to know what happened, because if they didn't, it was going to be happening again. She was very, very strong on that. And I hear her in my head sometimes when I speak, because this was her mantra.
Our family consisted of mum and dad, an elder sister who had left Germany in 1936, brothers 2 years older than I, and I was the baby of the family.
My parents and I had only recently come back to Berlin, so temporarily we were staying with some cousins.
My sister had been pushing my parents to leave. There was total resistance to that. And why should he leave a place where his family had lived for 200 years or more?
I remember the typewriter going constantly. Applications to emigrate for the parents and me.
Kristallnacht itself, I knew nothing about. I slept through the whole thing. All I knew that evening was that, unusually, my father wasn't at home. I discovered afterwards that he had been hiding in his office all night.
All I really remember is how agitated my parents and the cousins were, or trying to look out of the window but not to be seen from outside until the morning when we woke up and there were the Jewish men sweeping up the glass. My father saying, I think the best thing would be to get out of here quickly. And Dad said, just keep walking, If you see a policeman passing you, don't stop, don't look at them, just walk. And I was frightened.
Because I didn't know anything about what was going on, I had no radio, and nobody telephoned to say what was going on, I went to school in the normal way. I was very lucky. I was met at the gate by one of the few teachers who was usually sympathetic. So he proceeded to enlighten me. The synagogue had been burnt down. There'd been a lot of arrests. You had better go home and don't even think of coming back to this school. That was the end of education.
The synagogues, well, some of them were still smouldering, the embers, the prayer books, and the sacred scrolls, the Torahs, just chucked into the street.
I couldn't go to school anymore, so I went to help my father in his business. While it was still going, he had a textile business. I was sent out with errands. I came back from one of these errands to find my dad just coming down the road, starting to look for me, and having been told off for being late, said, well, next week you're off on the kinder transport. So I was the last to go, which was must have been absolutely terrible for both my parents.
Decision was taken to enroll me in a kinder transport. Now I well remember the last train journey was saying goodbye at the station and being told to look out of the window at the next station but one. They must have taken a taxi to
to the next station by Bohn, and there they were on the platform waving to me, the last wave. And that is my last image of them running along the platform waving. We must all treat each other with the dignity and respect they deserve. Never, ever be condescending.
As soon as you start identifying somebody as being different and talking up the idea that these different people are a danger to you, a danger to your community, a danger to your nation, you're on a slippery slope.
Thank you very much. Can I have a switch over, and can I invite Mr. Rudiger Bohn, Deputy Head of Mission of the German Embassy, onto the stage, and with Ruth-Anne and Elsa Shamash, can take her seat in the audience, please. Thank you.
This is an opportunity for us to have a little discussion between us about how the Holocaust is taught in schools, education, and how it's remembered in our different national contexts. And I'm sure there are challenges that cross over between us and similar, and maybe there are also some distinctive challenges to our country's way that we address Holocaust education. I wondered if you'd like to start us by telling us a little bit about the situation in Germany.
Yeah, thank you very much. And first of all, thank you very much. I feel very honored to be here with you and commemorate the horrible events that took place 84 years ago in Germany. I think at that time, 84 years ago, Germans did not only lose their moral compass, they also lost their human dignity, if you will, because they were, of course, not only SR stormtroopers who burned down synagogues or looted synagogues, killed people, and so on. There were also many normal Germans involved. So this is, of course, important to understand. I think it's part of our understanding of our historical role today. Therefore, Holocaust education is so important in Germany. And thinking about what we call the November pogroms always reminds me of a book that I read some years ago by Joachim Fest, who is a relatively well-known political writer in Germany. He wrote a big book about the Hitler era, Nazi period in Germany. And at the end of the book, he poses the question, what is actually the lesson learned from the Nazi time? And his answer is that the lesson learned is that a relatively highly civilized country like Germany in the 1920s could easily and very fast slide back into a barbaric dictatorship. And a friend of Joachim Fest, Golo Mann, who is the son of the famous German novelist Thomas Mann, who worked then in Germany as a historian, he went even further and said, in a world where this could happen, and he referred to the crimes of the Nazis, anything can happen at any time. This is, of course, an extremely pessimist view, and I think we should not teach our young people at school this extremely pessimist view, but it is, of course, important to remind young people of our past, of what happened in Germany during the Nazi period, and that we should be able to defend our freedom and democracy today. So all this is important, not only for Germany, also for other countries, but what is maybe different, as you mentioned, different national perspectives, what is different for Germany, that of course, Holocaust education in Germany is not only about historical facts and about values and moral standards. It's important to make young people in Germany understand what it means to be a responsible citizen of today's Germany, modern Germany, and that future generations also bear this moral responsibility vis-a-vis Jews in Germany and other countries, vis-a-vis the State of Israel, that this is important. And I would even say Holocaust education is kind of an initiation ritual, if I may say so, for young people in Germany that are on their way to become responsible citizens of my country. Holocaust education, maybe you know that Germany is a federal state or federal country. We are composed of 16 federal states. And so we have 16 different school systems, 16 different curricula, but Holocaust education is very well anchored in the respective curricula. There's a central committee responsible for educational questions in Germany that also looks to it that there is the same level of Holocaust situation anchored in the curricula, in the school books. The focus is in grade 9 and grade 10 on Holocaust education. And then in what we call secondary school, it comes back on the agenda very prominently in the 11th and 12th grade. So it's broadly anchored in the school curricula. But this is, of course, just one part of Holocaust education. We have in Germany now around 2,000 memorial sites, mostly concentration, former concentration camps, other memorial sites, museums, where school children go to, they visit the concentration camps, they are informed what happened in these camps, and also, of course, the background, what led to the Nazi regime in the first place. We have something that I would call teach the teacher, so it's also important to enable teachers in Germany to be good Holocaust educators, if you will, also by looking at best practices in other countries. And yeah, that is mainly the core of what we would call Holocaust education.
That's fascinating. Thank you very much for that. In the UK, in the institution that I work at, UCL Centre for Holocaust Education, we too feel that it's critical to invest in our teaching community in order to equip them to be able to teach the Holocaust well. And when we conducted research into this area in 2009, we found that whilst many teachers felt it was important to teach about this subject, they also were very conscious of how difficult it is. And they felt very nervous about the emotional weight of teaching the subject. And very few had had any training in 2009. And they also, we noticed some critical gaps in knowledge as well. That we felt, you know, teachers needed to have help and support in developing their knowledge to teach it well. And teachers in the UK have a challenge of time, of how much time the curriculum will allow for teaching the subject. And, of course, that determines what they teach in the short time that they have. And in 2009, we were quite concerned that some critical areas of the Holocaust weren't explored, things such as Jewish life before the war. And we felt, as a university, we needed to address that problem. And because we felt unless teachers are teaching their students about the life before, how are young people going to understand truly the human story and what was lost? So we tried to build a program that is going to support teachers teaching that element. Other aspects we found were lacking when we did some research with students as well, and we found when we interviewed students and surveyed students, there were misconceptions that were hard to challenge, that were deeply embedded in young people's understanding of the Holocaust, even after they'd studied it. And one of the ones relates to something that you picked up on about ordinary people, ordinary individuals of countries occupied by Nazi Germany being involved in the Holocaust, being collaborators, being co-perpetrators, being bystanders. And when we interviewed students, when we asked them who is responsible for the Holocaust, the vast majority was saying Hitler and Hitler alone, Hitler and a few others. And so our work is trying to help young people understand that it was all more complicated than that and far more complex than that and more discomforting than that. That ordinary people like you, like me, were involved in the most horrendous crimes in all sorts of different ways, whether it be driving trucks or stamping registers or being a librarian and not giving the books to the Jewish people coming in because that's what they've been told to do, and playing their little part, and that the Holocaust was a social endeavour. So we have those sorts of challenges, misconceptions that are deeply rooted.
Yeah, I could also only say I fully agree. I mean, it is important that teachers are well prepared for Holocaust education because it's, of course, different than teaching mathematics. I remember when I was a pupil at school, we went to the concentration camp in Buchenwald. And our teachers were not really well prepared, and I also felt that they were, in a way, insecure of what to tell us, how to explain what happened in this concentration camp. Of course, it was a very emotional visit for the teachers, for the pupils or students at school. But as you say, it is extremely important that teachers are enabled to be good Holocaust educators. I mean, here in the UK, I see that you have many Holocaust survivors and also next generation survivors, if you will. In Germany, I'd say we have more of these historic sites or historical sites, concentration camps, but also very, I'd say, very good museums that really give a very good understanding of what the Nazi period was and what the background of the Holocaust was. Looking to an even better way for Holocaust education, I think that it might be important, if it's well prepared, to also visit concentration camps like the one in Auschwitz, today's Poland, which is, of course, different from visiting a concentration camp in, let's say, central Germany or so. I remember that my wife went to the concentration camp in Auschwitz in the 10th grade, and it really made a lasting impression on her. To go there is, of course, has to be well prepared, but this is something that is extremely important for young people. Yeah, and of course, this is also something that might be interesting for many school children outside Germany to understand what happened in that terrible time.
The reality on our ground is that is a rare opportunity, sure. I think, generally, especially with the context of schools. And it's a rare opportunity. Mm-hmm. So for us, I think at UCL, Center for Holocaust Education, I know we have the Holocaust Memorial Day Trust here represented today and the marvelous work that they do nationally. The emphasis is really on work in schools, and work with students in classrooms, and to engage students in such a skillful way that they're able to relate and absorb to stories and testimonies like we've heard from Else tonight, and to be able to sort of own that, to invest in those individuals, because of course our survivors are getting rarer and rarer. And so I think it's the teaching profession that I think can take this forward and can really make a difference. And I've seen it happen, that young people learn about survivors and their stories, or victims and their stories who've passed a long time ago. But it's done so well that they talk about these individuals in the present, because it has that impact.
I fully agree. I mean, as you mentioned, future challenges for Holocaust education, that's exactly one of the challenges. In Germany, as in the UK, there are demographic changes. There are less and less survivors, and so it's important to have also recorded testimonies of survivors, because to hear these stories is extremely valuable as a means of Holocaust education. And also there are less and less grandparents available, if you will, that lived in the time of the Nazi period. It's also important, I think, it was of course important for young children or young people to talk to their grandparents and learn from their experiences and their insights. And we are now moving into new generations without these grandparents or also survivors. So we have to look to different ways for Holocaust education. And in Germany, I think there's also another challenge. The composition of the population is changing. We have more and more young people at German schools that have a migration background, as we say. They come from countries that have really nothing to do with the Holocaust. And they also have to understand what the Nazi past and the Holocaust means for Germany, for the next generations, and what it means, as I said at the beginning, to be a responsible German citizen. So all these things are challenges, but can be coped with, I think, also in cooperation with other countries, with the UK and others.
Absolutely, I 100% agree. And of course, something we haven't mentioned, but we won't have time tonight, is Holocaust denial and yes, the increase of anti-Semitism, which I think both our countries are suffering from and recognise is a major problem. And so part of that is to address that head on, but it's also to ensure that our Holocaust education is secure, is good, is of top quality, so that our young people, when they see things on the internet, social media, they can recognize distortion, trivialization, and mockery.
Absolutely.
Which is now getting more and more commonplace.
Yeah, here I would like to mention that we send every year almost 200 young people to different countries. There's an organization that is called Action Service Reconciliation. And they send almost 200 German and Polish young people to different countries to engage with Holocaust survivors. Also to the UK, there are currently 10 young Germans here in the UK working with and engaging with Holocaust survivors and in London and beyond. Mm-hmm. This is also a good way, I think, to stay together cooperate. And of course, one last issue, we are of course very proud that we were heading the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance in 2020-2021. And in that time, we contributed a lot to establishing a definition of what anti-Semitism actually is, a definition that is now broadly used internationally.
Absolutely, absolutely. And in 2024, IRA is being held here in the UK. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for having me. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Ruth-Anne and Mr. Rudiger Bohn. Ruth-Anne, you are free to sit down and enjoy the next segment, which is music for us to reflect and think about all the conversations that we've heard about, learned from. And the floor is now over to City of London Sinfonia. Thank you.
Idea of an infinity mirror, the glass, where you see yourself for infinity.
Thank you.
And you hear in the clarinet part at the beginning the rain just on the window pane, little droplets of rain.
What a special evening it's been for us to be a part of. Something I'm struck with is how, from the stories we see, that despite the absolute horror of the night of Kristallnacht, people went out with their brooms and their buckets the next morning and cleaned up and kept going. The kind of resilience that took to make new lives in new countries, my grandmother included, who came over from Berlin, setting up a new life, new generations, and we keep going and keep remembering. And we are going to play a piece by Purcell, where I play what is called a ground bass. It's a set of notes, and I keep going with it. And a beautiful duet above. I feel it sums up the human spirit.
Thank you.
Messiaen's Quartet for the End of Time, which was composed in a prisoner of war camp at the end of the war in Germany. And it was composed for piano, violin, clarinet and cello, because those were the musicians that were with Messiaen at the time. And it was first performed in the prisoner of war camp. And this is the fourth movement, the interlude. And there are many, many different emotions in this piece. There is dance, there is, I don't know about happiness, there's playfulness, there's anger, there's all sorts.
Represents the spirit of freedom, the spirit of freedom to be who you are and fly. So starting with a lovely folk song, a Welsh folk song about the blackbird, and finishing with a very famous blackbird song by McCartney. Singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes. make them see. This moment to be free. This concludes the evening. Saves me to say thank you to Elsa Shamash for telling her story, for Mr. Rudiger Bohn for being honest and open and very informative about the state of education in Germany. There's, I think, a lot of hope. And to Ruth-Anne for beautifully facilitating and asking the right questions, like you always do. You are always amazing. I want to thank all our speakers. I want to thank City of London Sinfonia for just being incredible. It has been an absolute privilege to work together, and I'm hoping that we can do a lot more. I want to thank everybody online and in the building for making and taking the time out to come here, to be in your living room and watching us. For people in the building, we can continue the conversation informally. Lastly, I would like to say a huge thank you to the people behind the scene, the people that you never see, the people who have facilitated and looked after the tech, the people who have booked the tickets for you, the people that are not seen. And lastly, very, very lastly, I'd also like to say a special mention about the cameraman who has filmed the survivors that we watched this evening. He's done this free of charge because he is a dedicated husband, my husband Lee Barnett. So I just want to mention that as well. For now, thank you for coming to JW3. We hope to see you again soon. Thank you very, very much.